I stayed at Cambridge. I actually went into the what we call the APU, the Applied Psychology Unit, which was owned and run by the Medical Research Council, which is just out, well, it's on the fringe of Cambridge and Chaucer Road, actually. It's a big old country house that had just been bought to turn into these laboratories. And in fact, a rather amusing story, the chap who bought it was a chap called Norman Mackworth, who was actually a medical doctor who was a research worker in our Department of Psychology. And he saw this house. He laid out his own money and bought this mansion, assuming or hoping that the MRC would follow it up, because he didn't want to lose it. He was so certain that this would make the most wonderful laboratory. It was a country house with lovely grounds, you see. And it worked out. His gamble paid off. He bought the thing in one weekend, told the MRC, the Medical Research Council, that he bought this thing. They absolutely did their nut, as you can imagine. But finally, coughed up, bought it, and it's in fact the biggest medical research laboratory outside London, actually. It's been very successful, indeed. And I started there. And it was a wonderful laboratory. It combined people having abstract general ideas with very, very practical problems. And I think that mixture of the theoretical and the practical, well, it certainly suited me. I think it suited a lot of people very, very well. I remember I wrote a long essay about the brain as an induction machine, following really from Bertrand Russell and thinking about induction and all this bit. And I still think these problems about how you gain knowledge by instances, generalising, then creating a hypothesis, which you then test, these things, which go on in science, is really what the brain also does. I think we are sort of little scientists inside our heads to a great extent. Anyway, I wrote an essay on that, which went on and on. And at the same time, I did practical things, some quite dramatic. I spent a year working on escaping from submarines for the Navy. Sir Frederick Bartlett, who was my professor, a wonderful man, really. And he was, again, a person I respect totally, looking back on him. He seconded me to the Navy for a year, actually, at Whale Island in Portsmouth. And I used to go down in these submarines, and then we did this big experiment where we changed the atmosphere, we increased the CO2, reduced the oxygen, as though one was in a stricken submarine, you see. And then I designed escape gear, a replica of the 42 operations required to get out of a submarine for each man, using a twill trunk system. No, sorry, using a gun tower system. But you had to, each chap had to get into the gun tower, open the lower hatch, get into it, close it, change the, put oxygen into it. Put the upper one up, then you had to drain the water out and hold it. There were 42 separate operations for each person, actually, to get out of this thing. Meanwhile, you had to wait to be discovered, because if you got out of the submarine when you're at the bottom of the sea and nobody knew you were there, you'd just get drowned. No point doing it. So what they did, they sat down there waiting to hear the screws of surface ships circling. Because, you won't believe this, but the sonar thing was on the bow of a submarine. The first thing that happened was that broke off if it hit the deck, you see, the bottom of the sea. And so they lost communications. It's quite extraordinary. And the only communication was listening to the screws of the surface vessel. So what I was working on was how long one should wait for to be discovered down there, you see, by surface ships, as the oxygen gradually failed and the CO2 gradually took over your consciousness, you know. And given that it was 42 operations for each chap, I mean, and then you had about maybe 50 chaps getting out of this thing, how long could you wait to start the escape? It's quite interesting. So I worked on that.